You me. Okay, good evening everybody. Welcome as always to the Dance Studies Colloquium, both those who've joined us in person and those who are watching remotely. Approximately 16 years ago, I was sitting at a conference in New Orleans feeling somewhat nervous as a fairly junior scholar when a woman leant across and whispered in a distinctive Australian accent, "Your paper was really good." Within 15 minutes, she'd whisked me outside, bought me a hot chocolate, grilled me on dance in British higher education, and tried to persuade me to accompany her on an alligator cruise. 16 years later, it's my pleasure to warmly welcome my friend, colleague, and mentor, Professor Rachel Fensham from the University of Melbourne. Those early impressions have held true ever since. She's curious, engaged, generous, and possesses an energy that embraces all that comes in her path. As a committed interdisciplinary scholar, she works across theatre and dance, and her books include The Doll's Revolution, To Watch Theatre and Dancing Naturally, and she's published chapters and articles on a diversity of topics, including dance costumes, effective and post-traumatic spectatorship, decolonizing dance studies, walking, falling, and choreographies of transmigration. She secured multiple prestigious research grants, which include studies of archival research methods, performance for Indigenous Australians, and the Dancing Naturally collection. And she also co-edits the New World Choreography Series for Palgrave Macmillan. She's quite frankly a powerhouse of ideas, and it's my great pleasure to welcome her to Temple University.
Thank you.
Very generous.
And look, I am really pleased to be here for many reasons, not least of which is to catch up with Cheryl, but also to have the opportunity to be again in a dance department. I moved back after teaching at Surrey to Australia, and while I love many of the things about where I'm working now, I do really miss having dance colleagues, so it was great to be invited as one of your scholars. And I should also just say, I don't usually apologise, I'm not big on apologising, but this is absolutely brand new work, and so I'm really keen to get your feedback. In fact, you know, any questions that you might have or suggestions about the things that I'm going to show you, I really would welcome at the end of the talk. So I'm taking a risk in giving the paper, but part of the incentive to come was to try and kind of look and think through some of this material on costume that I'm working on. So I've called the paper Frocked by Lugya, and I will start. In my current research, I'm examining how costumes perform, literally, politically, and aesthetically, in relation to a range of choreographic artists and works from the 20th and 21st century. Dance costumes exist, I argue, as material objects and as artifacts of choreographic thinking that exceed, temporally and spatially, the momentary event of performance itself. While theatre costumes, as Aoife Monks has argued, may have a specific life in the history of character or stage production, and thus with a referential connection to social reality, dance costumes are designed to move, and thus always draw attention to the embodied life of materials, reminding us through their weight of the shape and flow of the dancing body or bodies which wear them. When costumes become archival objects, they still bear the traces of performance, since they have been worn and discarded, and perhaps also loved, collected, and preserved. In so many ways, these material conditions in the life of a costume reveal something also about the affective histories that they have possessed. With the exception of Priya Srinivasan, who has drawn attention to the labour exchanges associated with the sweating sari in the archives and contemporary practices of Indian dance, this active relationship to performance is often only marginally noted within dance writing and reception in relation to costumes. It's often the case that we are less aware of costumes, and this is a quote, the more powerfully they can determine our expectations by setting the scene and ensuring normative or generic behaviour without being open to challenge, end quote, within the aesthetics of a given production. particularly in purist versions of modern and postmodern dance, the singularity of artistic authorship, the agency on the part of the dancer or choreographer, often decline or demean the messy reminders of artistic and production contexts, which include costume. By way of contrast, my study of costumes rejects the idea that costumes signify as singular objects. And I've written elsewhere about the ways in which they function through repetition and multiplicity. What's of interest to me are the repeated patterns, the many stitches, and the many occasions of wearing, as well as the adaptions and multiples that are replaceable or transferable across a composition or repertoire. These material dynamics in the object-oriented effects of costume also provide a means, I suggest, of rethinking the political and social dimensions of choreography as systems of transaction, because the materiality of their contemporaneous production, as well as helping to amplify ideas about what it means to move and to be seen in costumes for choreography. As a result, this study requires me to understand debates and methods in the burgeoning field of costume studies, where much recent work has been concerned with the narratives that might be told from material objects that circulate in a complex weave of personal story, of use and exchange values, social economies, family and cultural memory making. The leading costume scholar, Donatella Barbieri, for instance, talks about the encounter with the costume as a form of quest in which the individual costumes ask us to reflect upon their journey. And she attributes the agency of the costume to its capacity to both produce and resist an affective response. In addition to programs, reviews, and photographs, dance costumes may be the only material evidence we have of the dancer's body as conceived and experienced by spectators. Although they may also be unreliable narrators, perhaps mute, unless we undertake the considerable work needed to locate the context of their design, construction, and use. I would concur with Barbieri that a costume is therefore a complex, charged object whose study crosses disciplines, and I have previously argued that costume objects also embody the appropriation and circulation of materials with these contemporary cultural ideas and events. These epistemological charges attached to costume are powerfully aided by affective memories and affordances that accrue from seeing and recalling the costume in performance. In relation to Dunham's Lagya, I want to begin by acknowledging Dunham's prominent contribution to Black and Afro-American, as a Black and African-American dance artist in the narratives of American modern dance. And here I would defer to the amazing dance scholarship by writers such as Tommy DeFrance, Susan Manning, and Joanna Didas in their seminal studies of her legacy, as well as recent studies of aspects of Dunham's work, such as the essay by Tayana Hardin on Southland, in which she argues for the archival quality of Black dance. Not because it provides the permanence of remains, but rather because it involves the historical preservation